Hello, and in this video we'll be having a look at the all risks yield. So before we begin, what is a yield? Well, essentially a yield is a forward-looking way of assessing an asset, and what it shows is a annual return as a percentage of its value or price. Yields are used particularly in valuing assets like property, and the way it's done is you look at the income stream, so the potential income stream you'll get from investing in a property, and you times this by a multiplier to give you the capital value of the property. Now this multiplier is calculated by doing 100 divided by the yield. So the yield is of actually fundamental importance when looking at the capital value and how properties are valued. And the all-risk yield is one of many different yields that exist. And the key fundamental point about the all-risk yield is that it reflects all the risks, as the name suggests, uncertainties, and likely beneficial prospects arising from that property. So implicit in this will also be growth arising from that asset. And how do we interpret yields? Well, basically, the higher the percentage, yield percentage, the more riskier the asset is, and the lower it is, the more closer it is to a risk-free asset, and the more secure it is. So what are the risks that are included and reflected in the all risks yield? Well, the first one is that they're legal, tax, and planning risks. So as we said, yields are a forward-looking way. So if a property has sole value deriving from its potential to be redeveloped or, you know, construction to take place, then there will be a risk associated with this. So i.e. will you get planning permission, etc. And this is likely to determine where the yield will sit. Similarly, you have transaction and management costs relating to a property. And how this translates in a risk is that there's a lot of uncertainty with calculating these costs, particularly as this is forward-looking and you're predicting. Then you also have illiquidity premiums. So this is the idea that things like leaseholds are illiquid. Why? Because they're not traded and they're not very attractive and tradable assets. So that means that there's additional risks associated with those sort of assets. Then there's also the tenant default and renewal risk. So for example, the renewal risk may be coming from the Landlord and Tenant Act, whereby the tenant may have some kind of legal right to be able to renew their lease. This might be a risk to you if they're on an under-rented property, for example. This may not be a risk to you, so it depends on the situation. And the default is fairly obvious. It's talking about the tenant not being able to pay the rent for the property. Also, the risk-free rate will impact the all-risk yield. So the risk-free rate is typically talking about bonds. And the thing is, if you're getting more returns out of a bond, i.e. getting more out of the risk-free rate, then property is going to be more and more risky, because you're going to get less out of it compared to the risk-free rate, and property is more risky. So you're better off going for the bonds. So this is going to be reflected in the all-risk yield because it's forward-looking. And the last one is to do with the depreciation of the property and it becoming old and decrepit. And again, it's because this is a forward-looking and we have to take into account the age of the property and what's happening to it. And the all-risk yield is calculated by the market rent divided by the price. So if you have a property which is not being rented at market rent, which is often the case, then you have to adjust the all-risk yield, which is derived through the market. And there are three main things that you consider when looking at how to adjust the all-risk yield. And remember, you go up if you want it to, if the asset is more risky, and you go down if it's less risky and it's a secure asset. And there are three fundamental factors we look at: value, time, and interest. So by value, we're looking at the security of the asset. So if the rent is below market rent, and the smaller the proportion of market rent the rent is, the more lower the yield will be, because the asset is going to be more secure, because you know the tenant is less likely to default or leave the property, because they can pay for it. And the reason why lower risks, lower yields relate to a lower risk is because investors are risk averse, so they will be valuing this security and they will want this lower yield. The second key factor is you look at time. So if you have a rent on a property for a long period of time and it's fixed, then in essence, this is more riskier because you have an inflation risk. And so if there's no periodic rent review, say for like 33 years, or there's a long period of time before there's a rent review, in essence, what you're doing is you're making your income insecure in real terms, because inflation will eat away at the value of what you're supposed to get from the income stream. So again, you need to look at the time of which the tenancy exists in the property. And then finally, is you final thing you need to look at when adjusting the all risk yield is the interest. Are you talking about a leasehold interest or a freehold interest? What perspective are you talking about? This is important because leaseholds are depreciating assets. And the reason for this is because, actually there's several reasons for this. For example, there are a lot more costs involved with leaseholds. So like we were saying before, there's transaction and management costs. And this equates to more uncertainties than calculating it, and thereby making them more risky assets, i.e. pushing the yield up. Then you also have this idea that in a leasehold you're bound by strong covenants, so you're not free to do as you please as with a freehold. Thereby, this would reduce the marketability of the asset, i.e. making it again more risky and pushing the yields up. And then these factors are taken into account even after we're looking at in leaseholds where there's usually a sinking fund. So what usually happens in leaseholds is that usually the leaseholder will pay the landlord a fund of money or different sums, and it will all take place in a fund. And the reason for this is to secure any kind of money for future scheduled major works, etc. So the thing is, even after doing this, there are still uncertainties relating to leaseholds and increasing costs. And from this, we can also tie to the fact that if interest rates go down or there's an increase in inflation, your sinking fund is probably not worth very much anyway. So all these factors put together, they make leaseholds very unattractive. And that's one of the reasons why they're so illiquid, and you have to attach a premium to the leasehold interest. And so for that reason, when you're looking at leaseholds, you have to adjust the all-risk yields to go up because you're increasing the risks. So essentially, the whole idea of all-risk yield is you're looking at a yield. So you're looking at the future in, potential of a property that as an asset from an investment point of view. But you're looking at the idea of how risky it is. And as you increase risk by, i.e. fixing a same fixed rent for a long period of time, or by increasing rent, making, you know, if it's a higher rent, so it's a bigger proportion of market rent rather than a lower one, you're adding more and more risk, and i.e. you're pushing the yield up. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed this video. Thank you for watching.